from the University of Grenoble, and he'll speak about homomorphisms of algebraic groups, representability and rigidity. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm very happy to give this talk in this seminar because I think I learned a lot by just attending the seminar. And there were some new topics to me and also some functorial approach to algebraic problems, which is again new to me and which will play a role in the talk. Still, I should warn you, but that this is my second talk online, and the first one was extremely bad, really very bad. So I hope this one will be a little bit improved. You will see. So anyway, let me start with some motivation and examples. The motivation comes from the classification of group actions, actions on a given algebraic group, on a given, say, proper scheme. So I'll work throughout this talk over a field of characteristic P, which is arbitrary. So when you have a proper scheme X, you can consider the automorphism group functor, which sends any scheme S to the automorphisms of X times S over S. And it's known that it's representable by a group scheme, which is locally of finite type. So this kind of group scheme will be called locally algebraic in the talk. And this group scheme I denote by OTEX. So it's a connected component of the identity is an algebraic group. This means group schemes of finite type, and every other connected component is also of finite type. But there may be many of them. So it's a formal remark that an action of an algebraic group G on X is just a homomorphism from G to odd X. And two actions are equivalent if these homomorphisms are conjugate by, say, Honest automorphism or K-rational automorphism. And so the classification of G actions on X is the same as describing some orbit space. You look at the set of all homomorphisms from G to OTX, and you consider the action of OTX by conjugation makes the orbit space. And if G is connected, then you can replace OTX with a Honest algebraic group of 0x. So let's try to formalize this construction. We consider an algebraic group G and a locally algebraic group H, which will be out our odd X. And then we consider the functor of group homomorphisms, which is defined as the functor of automorphisms. You look at homomorphisms of GS to HS as S groups. And these are the same as morphisms from G times S to A to H. Morphisms are schemes which are multiplicative in the variable G. So I just write this notation. And then there are two kind of obvious questions. The first one is, when is this functor represented by some scheme? And if this is the case, then we have an action of H on this scheme by conjugation, which comes from the action of H on itself by conjugation. And is there a way to describe the orbits? So we will see some partial answers in the talk. Actually, there is a kind of satisfying answer if you put the two questions together. About representability, I only know some partial answers. But let me point out that this homomorphism functor is a more refined information than the set of homomorphisms from G to H or from GK to HK for all field extensions big K of small K. Because if you start with the additive group GA, and you consider characters of the additive group. So these are homomorphisms from GA to GM. And you know very well that these characters don't exist over a field. So there is only a trivial character. But actually, this Homm functor is not representable because there are lots of homomorphisms over a non-reduced base. For example, in characteristic zero, you take the exponential series, which is not quite algebraic, and you truncate it by considering it over some local ring where the parameter is nilpotent. So it's a classical construction. I will not give it in detail, but you have to remember some homomorphisms are not representable. And GA is a first example. Here is a very small example. If you look at endomorphisms of the multiplicative group, then you get what you expect. This is a constant scheme, Z. And these homomorphisms are just power maps. And this is not quite a trivial fact because you have to look at families of homomorphisms parameterized by a connected scheme, S. But the fact is that every homomorphism only depends on the first variable and is a power. This is called rigidity of Torrey in general. And I mentioned this example because, okay, the constant scheme Z is not a big deal, but still it's not an affine scheme because it's not quasi-compact. And it's not of finite type either. There are just too many connected components for this. So you cannot expect to for your representing scheme to be a honest, a fine variety. But actually, one can show that this representing scheme is always locally of finite type. This means it's covered by open subsets, open subschemes of finite type. And this is a completely formal argument, which consists in quoting EGA at the proper place. Okay. So the first remark is, result from EGA, sorry, is that this functor commutes with direct limits if you view it as a functor of some algebras to sets, not a scheme to sets. And then the fact that a functor commutes with direct limits characterizes locally of finite type for representable functors. So general statement is locally of finite presentation, but over a field, it's the same. So then for the talk, we will just consider schemes which are locally of finite type. Then let me give some more consistent examples with finite groups. And the first observation is if you look at homomorphisms from a finite group scheme to an algebraic group, then you get a scheme of finite type which represents this functor. And the reason is quite simple. First of all, this group homomorphisms are closed in the in the morphisms of schemes. This is a formal consideration. And then if you look closely at Homm XH, where X is a finite scheme, then what you find is a veil restriction of H by the map from X to spec K. This is just because you write the definitions and you find the same functor. And you know very well that the veil restriction of an algebraic group is another algebraic group. The reason is that algebraic groups are quasi-projective. And so every finite set of points of them is contained in an open affine. And this is the condition for veil restriction to exist. Okay, so we have this simple argument to show that this scheme exists. And then if G has an order which is prime to the characteristic, in particular in characteristic zero, then this scheme is smooth and consists in only finitely many orbits over the algebraic closure of K. I will sketch the proof later because there are some ingredients which are maybe better explained in general. Let me point out that this condition of order of G prime to the characteristic is really necessary because if you look at the simplest example, a group of order P acting on homomorphisms to the additive group, then you get the affine line over which the additive group acts trivially because it's a commutative group. So conjugation action is trivial. So you see over an infinite field, there are infinitely many orbits. Okay, so that's a nice and simple picture for finite groups. And this will be a part of the general story. So let me move to the main result and start with the old theorem of Grothendieck in schema en groupe. So this goes back to the beginning of the 60s. And it states the following. If you have an algebraic group of multiplicative type, this means that over the algebraic closure of the base field K, the group becomes diagonalizable. It's a subgroup of torus. So this will be our source group, and the target group H is supposed to be smooth and affine. And then the functor of homomorphisms is represented by a smooth scheme M, and the morphism that I write here is smooth, okay? So that's the way Grothendieck formulates this theorem, and maybe it's not so simple to understand. And let me reformulate it as follows. So you consider this morphism gamma, and you see this is a morphism of M schemes, where M is a second factor. Over the second factor is the identity. So you make a base change by prescribing this second factor. This means given every field extension and every F from GK to HK, the conjugation of F by H is a smooth morphism. And you think of this as an orbit map for the conjugation action. And since images of smooth morphisms are open, you see that every H orbit in M is open. And this is the way we will use this result of Grothendieck. So now I'm on the next slide, which is where I try to state the main result of the talk. So first of all, definition, which looks very classical. I say that an algebraic group is linearly reductive if every finite dimensional representation is semi-simple, okay? So this is very classical again, if the group is affine, but in this talk, I will consider algebraic groups which are possibly non-affine. And so you will see some very strange examples of this notion. And the first one is abelian varieties. So for an abelian variety, which is a smooth connected proper group scheme, there is no representation at all. So every representation is trivial, so the condition is trivially satisfied. but there are more natural examples. And the first ones are groups of multiplicative type. This was shown by Grothendieck also, and it's not difficult. And the main theorem says that if you have a linearly reductive group as a source and a smooth group scheme as a target, then Grothendieck's theorem holds with exactly the same statement. So you get a smooth scheme which represents your functor, and this morphism is smooth. And you have the same consequence that the orbits are open. So let me give an application of this theorem. This is over an algebraically closed field K. And I will go back to the first setting where I consider the set of homomorphisms and the orbit of the group H of K by conjugation. And the claim is the quotient of this homo set by H of K doesn't depend on the algebraically closed field K. So in more precise words, you have a natural bijection from a small field, small k, to a big field, big k, if you have an algebraically closed field extension. And this is not a new result. It was first observed by Weinberg in this year as a kind of side remark at the end of a paper. And this was for G reductive and H smoothifying. And Margot extended it to this setting here. And this is actually the main result of the paper by Margot, which is in Documenta. And let me explain how this follows from the previous result. First of all, you are over an algebraically closed field, and you have a scheme of which is locally of finite type. So you see this scheme as a disjoint union of open orbits of k rational points. And in particular, the orbits of the neutral component of H are just the connected components because they are open and disjoint. And so this orbit space over there is just, first of all, you make the quotient of M by H naught, and you divide by H mod H naught. And this quotient M mod H naught is just a set of connected components of M, which I denote by pi zero of M. And H mod H naught is also the set of connected components of H. And both sets don't depend on the algebraically closed field you're working on, because geometric connected components are independent of the algebraically closed field. So you get just this for free. Now, I will first explain how these linearly reductive groups look like. And first I will remind you of the structure of affine linearly reductive groups, which is well known and goes back to Nagata. So, well, this was extended by de Masure and Gabriel to group schemes because Nagata worked for algebraic groups which were implicitly smooth. So the result is the following. If you have an affine algebraic group in characteristic zero, it's linearly reductive if and only if its identity component is a reductive group in the sense of reductive group schemes. This means over the algebraic closure, you get a connected reductive group. And in positive characteristics, what you get is much less because a group G is linearly reductive if and only if its neutral component is a group of multiplicative type. And the quotient G mod G naught is a finite group, of course, which has order prime to the characteristic. So this is Nagata's result. And in the paper of Margot, which I mentioned, you find some additional results, which are quite useful. First of all, the class of affine linearly reductive groups is stable under taking normal subgroups, quotients, and extensions. It's very easy to see that it's stable under quotients, because representations of a quotient are just certain representations of acting the starting group. The other statements, for example, for extensions, for example, are not trivial at all. And a very useful fact is this notion of linearly reductive is invariant under field extensions. So the statement is an affine group is linearly reductive if and only if it is so after some field extension or all field extensions. So to continue to go to non-affine group, I have to remind you of another classical result, which is called the affinization theorem, which more or less reduces the structure of general algebraic groups to some affine part and some other part, which I will just define. And the statement is quite simple. Every algebraic group has the largest affine quotient group, which I will denote as G with an F in exponents. And the kernel of this quotient map, which I will call N, is smooth, connected, central in the neutral component, and has only constant regular functions. So this, I write it in this way. This O of N is a ring of global regular functions on N, or the global structure, global sections of the structure sheaf. And the condition is you only get the ground field. So these groups N are called anti-affine. And by the theorem, they are all smooth connected and commutative. And there is a rather easy structure of these groups, which I will not recall, but let's just say they are really concrete objects you can work with. And the observation now is every representation of your group G factors through the affinization. And so G is linearly reductive if and only if its affinization is linearly reductive. Okay. And also this construction of G F and N, commutes with extension of the base field, because this is a construction of the affinization, which takes the spec of O of G, and this commutes with base extension field. And so what you get is that G is linearly reductive if and only if the base extension GK is. And it's also not hard to see that this class of linearly reductive groups is stable under extensions. Quotients is again very easy. It's not stable under taking normal subgroups, and it's a kind of small tricky point, which I will maybe skip. Okay. So now I can explain how these linearly reductive groups are made. And again, the result will depend on the characteristic. So in characteristic zero, the linearly reductive groups are those which lie in an exact sequence like this, where at the extremes, you have finite groups here and here. And in the middle, you have the product of an anti-affine group with a reductive group. So morally, they are isogeneous to a product of anti-affine by reductive. Okay, so this will be very useful to prove the main result, as I hope you will see. And in characteristic P, then again, you should expect much less, many a much smaller class, and actually what you get is almost a class of semi-abelian varieties. So the semi-abelian varieties are just extensions of abelian varieties, which are quotients by tori. And then these groups are smooth, connected, obviously. They are commutative. This is a kind of exercise. And they are also linearly reductive because their affinization is just a quotient of the torus. Abelian variety doesn't count. So it's certainly linearly reductive. And then you get the next statement. So in positive characteristic, the linearly reductive groups are just extensions of finite linearly reductive groups by semi-abelian varieties. And here, finite linearly reductive is rather concrete. If F is smooth, then it just means that its order is prime to the characteristic. If it's not smooth, then what you can add is infinitesimal group of multiplicative type. For example, pf roots of unity or products of pn roots of unity. So okay. You get this.
So Michel, I have a question. Yes. Could you remind us in characteristic P, what yes. are the anti-affine, because that's your result and I'm
Okay. So I should say, thank you. That's my own result. I wanted to highlight.
Yes.
Anyway, the fact is in characteristic P, the anti-affine groups are certain semi-abelian varieties, where the extension is as non-split as possible, morally. And so that's actually half of the proof of this proposition.
Okay, merci.
Any other questions so far? Okay, so let me try to continue. Okay, so let me finally sketch the proof of the main theorem. I hope you remember there were two statements. First of all, some factor is representable. And secondly, the representing scheme is smooth and the group action on it is also smooth in some sense. So I will start with representability, and there will be a long series of reductions. And I will try to sketch them in an ordered way because it's a kind of long story where every step is easy, but there are many of them. So first of all, if you have an exact sequence of algebraic groups like this one, and you're interested in the representability of morphisms from G to H, then you can think that morphism from G to H are just morphisms from G tilde to H, which are N invariant. And that's actually the main result of descent theory in this setting. And it tells you in particular that this Hom functor from G to H is closed in the big one. So if you know that the big one is representable, then you will also know that the small one is representable by a small closed subscheme of the big one. And then you can go to a larger group, G tilde, which hopefully has a simpler structure and work only with this G tilde. And another favorable case is when this tilde, G tilde is a semi-direct product of some normal subgroup by an acting group. And then you see very easily that this homomorphisms from G tilde to H form a closed subfunctor of the product of homomorphisms. And the idea is just to restrict a homomorphism to both factors and see what you get. And you get a closed condition by writing that a pair of homomorphisms satisfy the compatibility conditions for a semi-direct product. So we will use this observation several times. Now I should know how to go to the next page. And let me start with a trick to get rid of finite quotients. So you start with an algebraic group G and assume that you have a normal subgroup with finite quotients. For example, the neutral component. And then by a result of myself, sorry, you can lift this finite quotient to the group somehow. And this means you can find a finite subgroup F of G such that G is a product of G1 in by F in this group. And more precisely, this gives you an exact sequence like this. So this is a semi-direct product of G1 by F acting by conjugation. The map here is the multiplication map, and the kernel is, of course, G1 intersected with F. And by the previous slide, you see that Homm of G to H is a closed subfunctor of Homm of this group to H, which is closed in this one. And I think you remember that for finite groups, this one is representable. This is also true for H locally algebraic by the same kind of argument. And so we can forget about this part and replace G with G1. And then we can further reduce to the case where G is reductive or anti-affine. And this is by the structure of linearly reductive group. Maybe I'll recall it and go back to this place. Okay, so in characteristic zero, you have this exact sequence. And by the remark I sketched, you can forget about this F2. You can also forget about this F1, and you're left with G1 or G2. And in characteristic P, this is even simpler. You go directly to this semi-abelian variety N. Okay, so that was some parts of this reduction. And now I will use a very nice result from SGA3, which is due to de Mazur, which says the following. If you have a reductive group G with a maximal torus T, then the restriction from G to T is a so-called relatively representable functor. Okay. So relatively representable means if you base change the target functor by a representable functor here, then what you get is another representable functor. And in particular, if you manage to prove that Homm group of TH is representable, then you know that this one is also representable. It's not a closed subfunctor because a homomorphism is maybe not uniquely determined by its values on a maximal torus, but the difference is rather small. And then you're left with a torus. And then I'll just skip the argument, which is long but not surprising. We'll just prove by hand that homomorphisms from a torus to any group are representable. And the core case is homomorphism from T to GLN, which is really an exercise in representation theory. So I won't give details on this, but it's not difficult. And one had another case, which is the anti-affine groups. And then one goes to books on abelian varieties and finds that the main tool there is a rigidity lemma. And if you adapt this rigidity lemma, you get and copy the arguments from abelian varieties, what you get is the following. If you have an anti-affine group, G, and a locally algebraic group, then group homomorphisms from G to H are equal to this gadget, which I will just define. But I think you can guess the definition. In G, you have a neutral element. In H, you have another one. And you just look at morphisms of schemes which send the neutral element to the neutral element. You can make them into a functor. And it's clear that this contains group homomorphisms as a subfunctor. And now the rigidity statement is that both coincide and they are represented by a commutative etal group scheme. Just like for tori, you have the same kind of statement. So why commutative etal group scheme? Because you can multiply pointwise this homomorphisms in the right hand side, right? You just multiply in the group H. And so you have a multiplication law. And it's commutative because the target is, lands in the homomorphism land in the anti-affine part of H. That's something easily proved. And now, if you put all these small pieces together, you get a proof of the representability part of the theorem. And of course, somewhere there is this original statement by Grothendieck, which is reproved, but it's in this setup, it's not so difficult.
So
and now I will.
I have a question. I have a yes. question. One more. When is this commutative etal group scheme finite in the proposition?
Almost never. Almost never, because if you take endomorphisms of an anti-affine group, right, then you get the nth power map for any positive and integer n, because this group is commutative. So the nth power map is a group homomorphism.
And, okay. Thank
since
you.
This group has no torsion, this nth power map gives you a copy of Z in this functor.
Michel, I'm a little confused as to why this is commutative.
Because I explained it badly. The point is, if you look at a honest homomorphism from an anti-affine group G to some group scheme H, then its image is always contained in the anti-affine part of H. This is just by definition of anti-affine. And so since anti-affine groups are commutative, you can just multiply homomorphism, group homomorphisms, and you get still group homomorphisms. And that's why it's commutative. Is it clearer now?
Oh, I guess I was confused with composition. So I was thinking about the case where each one, G and H, are say products of two elliptic curves.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not commutative under composition, but I guess the group law is different here. It's just multiplication
the group law here
and
is
H.
Just multiplication on the target.
Okay, I got it.
And
thank you.
Okay, so just addition, if you think. As in a commutative group, you take addition of morphisms and it's still a homomorphism. Okay. Further questions?
Yeah, I have one question, which yes. I have from a long time ago. So you talk about closed subfunctors.
Yes.
So is it closed subfunctor means that if you make a base change to a representable functor on the right hand side and you pull back, then it's going to be a closed embedding?
Oh, yes, you're right. And, sorry?
Does it mean that if you have a map from F to G, and then you have a map from a scheme? At the functor to G, and you pull back, and then you want the pullback to be representable, and the map there to be a closed immersion.
That's exactly this definition.
Okay. Right.
And thank you for pointing this out. I should definitely have said it, but fine. So now you can understand the beginning of the talk. Sorry. Anyway, so let me finally explain or sketch how you prove smoothness. And actually, you just have to read the original proof of Grothendieck and understand what he's doing. And then you get the following lemma, which is the way you understand things. So if you consider an algebraic group and a smooth group scheme and assume for concreteness that this Hom functor is represented by a scheme, then you have three conditions. The first one is the same statement as the theorem, this map kind of graph of the action is smooth. The second one is a consequence that I already used, that if you specialize this map or pull back this map by a base change on M, you get a smooth map. And the third one is what some kind of useful reformulation, that you have the following vanishing of a Hochschild cohomology group. So for any field extension, big K of small k, and any F, which will be a morphism from GK to HK, then this cohomology group vanishes, where this denotes, of course, the Lie algebra of HK, and GK acts on this Lie algebra well as it can, because it acts through the adjoint representation of HK composed with the morphism from GK to HK. Okay, and sentence is not quite correct, but you understand what it means. If G is linearly reductive, then it's easy to believe that this H1 vanishes. So the conclusion holds. So how to understand this last condition? Well, geometrically, it's very simple, because this H1 is exactly the normal space to the orbit. Let me remind you, you have an orbit map from HK to MK, which is exactly this one. So this its image is supposed to be a locally closed subvariety of MK and smooth. And so you just consider its normal space at the base point F, the quotient of the tangent space to MK by the tangent space to the orbit. And if you look carefully, you find this H1. So the vanishing of this H1 means that locally at this point, the orbit is the same as the whole space. And actually, that's almost a proof if you just fit in the computation of differentials which are involved in this statement. So with this, one can easily conclude the proof, and I still have some kind of remark. First of all, there is a partial converse. So suppose that you have an algebraic group G, and assume that the main theorem holds as stated for any target H. Actually, you only need H to be smooth and affine. And the conclusion is that G is linearly reductive. And actually, the proof is an exercise on the former criterion, because you see, you have this vanishing of cohomology for all possible Lie algebras of groups H. And you deduce by some small tricks that the cohomology of GK with all possible coefficients vanishes. And then GK is certainly linearly reductive. So that's not a deep fact. And you have just to cook up some arbitrary modules from Lie algebras, but it's again a simple trick. But then, so it says that the main result is close to optimal if you ask for the full statement, representability and smoothness. But about representability, I don't know really the characterization. And actually, probably the reasonable question to ask would be to characterize the algebraic groups G, such that these Hom functors are always representable, whatever this H is. And only have a partial result, which says that if the affinization is an extension of a finite group by a reductive group, then this works. And in positive characteristics, this gives you a much bigger class, because for linearly reductive groups, this GF was an extension of a finite group by a torus. And here you just replace torus by reductive, so you get many more. In characteristic zero, you get exactly the same. And the proof, well, the kind of reduction that I sketched gives this easily, but I don't know whether this is the optimal class. On the other hand, if G has a quotient GA, then the answer of this question is certainly negative. So you, well, you have to avoid unipotent groups in some way, but I don't see clearly what you should get. Okay, sorry, this is a bit early, but
I was wondering that last question, Michel, mm-hmm. that on your last slide.
Yes.
What is known about affine groups?
I don't even know the answer for affine groups. And that's probably the best place to start, but even so, I'm not sure what I get. I only know the small positive direction, where your affine group is an extension of a finite group by a reductive group. This is okay. And that's all I know.
I have a question about an early part of the talk where you mentioned the connected component of the automorphisms. Mm-hmm. So this is not, it's only locally algebraic. So the connected component, does it have to be open? Is it closed, I guess. Is it well-defined all the time? How do you define it?
For locally algebraic groups, it's well-defined. And it's some statement that you find in the book of De Masure and Gabriel, that for a locally algebraic group, first of all, the connected component of the identity is a honest algebraic group. It's open and closed. And every connected component is open and closed. That's always true for schemes of which are locally of finite type, because they are locally Noetherian. And for groups, every connected component is of finite type, which is a non-trivial result. Of course, over the algebraic closure, the connected components are just as translates of the connected component of the identity, so are all the same. But over a non-closed field,
you
get slightly larger ones, but still they are of finite type. Okay, so does it answer the question?
Yes, thank you.
And again, the only reference I know is De Masure Gabriel or SVA3. So, well, in the book of Min, from the start, all groups are algebraic, so this doesn't exist.
Okay. Any other questions? Well, if there are no other questions, let's thank the speaker again.